Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
What a remarkable crowd. It is truly a miracle that some of you are here. We are delighted, we are honored. And we're believing God that God will do some wonderful, amazing things. How many say amen to that?
Amen.
I want you to say this out loud, if you will, please, after me. God,
tonight
I'm asking you to release your Holy Spirit,
to do whatever He wants to do.
I now give you permission to minister to me tonight. I give your Holy Spirit permission to do whatever He wants, however He wants to do it. Amen. Now give Jesus a big hand clap. Yeah. You may be seated. The message will be short. How many say amen to that? Oh yeah, a few. Yeah, I know. All right. I just want to talk to you for a few minutes about moving in the supernatural and dealing with some issues that people have when it comes to believing God for a miracle. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 4, Paul said, "And my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom," now watch this, "but in the demonstration of the Spirit and power." So when Paul preached, his preaching, his speech, was to be in demonstration of God's Spirit and power. The word demonstration in the Greek language literally means showing something so you can see it. Displaying something. And tonight, we are believing with all of our heart that God will show up and display His supernatural power. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
If I did not have the demonstration of God's Spirit and God's power, I would wonder what was wrong with me. Because that is God's promise to every believer. Can you say amen?
Amen.
When it comes to healing, one of the things we need to get rid of is this. It's not my gift. Well, I want to tell you something. It's not a gift. It's simply believing the Word of God. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
There's no such thing as a healing evangelist. There may be an evangelist who goes about healing the sick. I constantly get people, leaders, pastors telling me, "Oh, it's all right for you, you can do this, but it's not my gift." And I say, God can function through any believer that'll say yes to Him. Come on, hallelujah. Come with me to Mark 16, verses 15 to 20. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word through accompanying signs. Wow. Now, where it says these signs shall follow them that believe, it's very important that we understand tonight the Greek here. The word believe literally means in the Greek a believing one in God. So he's saying these signs will follow those that are believing ones in God. Not those that believe in signs, wonders, and miracles. Not those that believe in the supernatural power of God, but simply those who are believing ones in God. Because it is God that does the signs, wonders, and miracles. It's the power of God. God is no respecter of persons. And if you are a believing one in God, he can flow to you and through you. When I was pastoring, I remember one night we were praying for a lot of sick people. And I got a young man up on the stage who had the call of God on him. I said to him, why don't you pray for the sick? He said, I've never done that before. I said, and God doesn't care. Come on, hallelujah. This is not based on experience. It's based on you being a believing one in God and God himself. Come on, hallelujah. He said, what do I pray? How do I pray? I said, I don't know. I'm not you. You pray. And all he did was go like this. God, help me tonight and heal the sick. Amen. That did it. People started getting healed. Come on, are you hearing me? It's God that does it. God that does it. In the four Gospels in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, miracles were not just for those identifying with Jesus and God. They were to be a sign to the unbelievers authenticating the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, when we go to developing nations, which in most cases are not developing, We pray first after we've ministered for the sick. And God does all kinds of miracles. Then we give an altar call after all of that has happened for people to get saved. Because they see that God is a miracle working God. No other religion that has some God can have that happen. For their gods are dead, and our God is alive and living. And so it's still a sign to authenticate the gospel to people. The second thing to get rid of is this statement, and it certainly is a faith-destroying statement. Heal me if it be your will. Well, you need to know if it is or it isn't. Come on, hallelujah. Heal me if it be your will. Well, this Bible, the New King James Version, even the NIV Version, even the Old King James Version, even the Amplified Version, the Living Bible Version, all show that healing is the will of God for every believer. I had a brother that had what was then an incurable disease. And he'd be hospitalized for up to 6 months at a time. And we had a minister come from a certain denomination, and he'd pray this prayer. Oh God, if it be thy will, heal this young boy. And I'd hear that and think, how stupid is that? I mean, I didn't know anything about church or God and didn't want to know. But to me, as an unbeliever, I thought that was dumb and stupid. Either you know and it is the will of God or it isn't. Not if it be thy will. And after he'd pray, and my mother would thank him for coming, and I'd walk down the path with him, I'd mouth off at him. I'd tell him, don't come back here if you don't know what God's doing or not doing. She would not have liked that. And I was young enough not to realize that I was out of order. But the point is, you can know that it is the will of God. So we're coming here tonight not hoping to get healed, not wishing to get healed, but believing Almighty God that His will is to heal us. Hallelujah. The healing provision is the believer's inheritance. Jesus is not only the testator who died, he was resurrected and is now the mediator of his will. It is God's will to heal people that are sick. He is now our advocate, and he will not cheat us out of our inheritance. The third thing to deal with is this. I don't have enough faith. Excuse me, I'm going to be extremely blunt, and I know I'm in America and we're supposed to be nice. In Australia, we're blunt. If we don't like something in Australia, we just tell you. Hello? They do that in South Africa, don't they? People say, what do you think of my new shirt? Don't like it. If I do that in America, they have to go for counseling. The statement, I don't have enough faith, is absolute rubbish. Boy, you can feel the crowd now. It's rubbish. Every born-again believer, the Bible says, was given the measure of faith. And the term the measure, and I preach this here, means literally 12 barrelfuls. We talk about barrels of oil. And the point is not really how much, but you have a lot of faith. God gave you a lot of faith. He gave you more faith than you know what to do with. People say to me, I wished I had faith like you. And I go, you do. You have as much as I have. I have as much as you have. God didn't come to some ministries or people and say, I'm going to give you more than anybody else. He gave us all the same amount of faith. The day we got saved, God imparted faith into us, so we had the ability to believe God for all of these things. I wrote a book. In fact, we gave it out here at a ministers' conference. It's called You're Full of It. One clap. One. One. Can you believe that? One. And it was talking about you're full of faith. When we took it to Cuba to give away, and we gave several thousand away, the guys from Ecuador that asked me if they could publish it in Spanish said to me, you're full of it doesn't translate very well. Is that right? Yeah, it just does not translate very well. And if you're in the wrong country, it means something else. Hello. The fourth thing you need to deal with is this. This is so tragic when people say this. God gave me this sickness. I have a dear, dear, dear friend. I love him dearly. He was struck down last year with a disease, and he had to give up his church as pastor. And there's two kinds of this particular disease. One moves slowly, one moves pretty fast. And he's got the one that moves fast. And I sent him an email. It's the only one of mine that he's never answered. And that's okay. I'm still his friend. I said to him, here's what I want to do. I want to come to your house, and you and your wife and that sleep during the night. I'll pray through the night for two or three nights. When you get up in the morning, I'll make sure I'm gone so I don't disrupt the household, so you can get healed. I meant it seriously. He's put on his website that this disease was given to him by God so he could understand how to minister to those that have that disease. Well, I'm here to tell you tonight, God does not give sickness to anybody. Come on. God does not do it. Now, I've been around long enough to understand that God can use different things to do things in our life, but He did not give it to us. Now, when you are ministered to, and you will be in a few minutes, understand God loves you dearly. God wants to heal you. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And in the Word of God, which I've said here before, some people were healed instantaneously, which we all love. That's happened to me. Some were healed as they went. Some were healed over a period of time. Don't give up. Don't give in. Understand that very often God starts from the inside and works to the outside. And know that God has begun to do a work in you. Understand from Ephesians 3:17, we are rooted and grounded. Come on, hallelujah. God has not abandoned you. God has not rejected you. God is not saying, I'm not going to do it. Hang in there. That's the hardest part. When I was laying in bed with cancer, a friend of mine came, he's a big, tall guy, and he said, I've come to visit you. I said, great, I'll be out of here soon, tomorrow. He said, who said? I said, I said. I'm leaving, man. He said, what if the doctor says you can't go? I said, I'm leaving. That's it. I'm believing God. I believe in God. I understand that God can use doctors. I'm all for that. But I'm leaving. But I want you to do something for me. I want you to go get a big piece of paper and write in big letters from the book of Isaiah chapter 53, by His stripes, and then over to 1 Peter chapter 2. By His stripes, I was healed. And then the scripture, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And I want you to pin it up on the ceiling above me. So every time I open my eyes, I see that and I read it. And God's word is light and life. Come on, hallelujah. So he goes away downstairs, he comes back 30 minutes later, he's got it, he puts it up there, it's huge. We talk, he's gone. Sometime later a nurse comes in and she sees me looking up and she looks up. She said, what's that? I said, don't you touch that. She said, what is it? I said, that's my prescription. Come on, hallelujah. That's my prescription. By His stripes, I was healed. I said, you touch that and you're in trouble. Do not touch it. My name is not Fury for nothing. But I've been saved. And I'm nice now. Well, when I wake up in the morning, I look up and it's gone. So I grab my phone, I call Barry, I said, I don't know what you're doing, but get back here to the hospital. He said, why? I said, those unbelievers took my prescription down. I want it back up there. He said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll bring it back, but I'll bring a supply of 4 other copies, so if they do it, you'll have to get somebody else to put it up there. Come on, hallelujah. He puts it up there, he's gone, she comes back later in the day. She said, we got rid of that. I said, I told you. Every time you get rid of that, we're putting it back up. Because I need that. Because every time I read that, it puts life into my body. Come on, hallelujah. I'm rooted and grounded. Now let me tell you something about being rooted and grounded. A friend of mine was in Finland, and he bought some shrubs to plant, a lot of them. And the guy in the nursery said to him, where are you going to plant these? And he told him. He said, oh, I know where that is. I know where that field is. It's got mountains on one side. He said, yep. And it's got great tall pine trees on the other. He said, that's right. And he said, at each end there's hills. So he said, there's no wind comes in there. He said, that's right. He said, oh, if you want these to grow, you're going to have to do something. He said, what? He said, you plant them, then you go outside every morning and every evening, and you go to each tree and you shake it violently. That will cause the shrub to get strong, and its roots will go down, so it will be rooted and grounded. Come on, are you hearing me? So when you go out of here, if you're getting shaken, don't freak out. It's okay. Your roots are going down deep. Come on. You're getting rooted and grounded. When the devil comes to you and tells you you can't be healed, you tell him God already did it. When the devil tells you it's not going to happen, you tell him it's already happening. Amen. If I don't quit, we'll have a long sermon. I heard that. I got good ears. Let every head be bowed and every eye closed. All over this auditorium, just like we did in the 3 services this morning and yesterday morning, I want to pray for the greatest miracle that can happen to a human being. That's the miracle of Jesus Christ coming into your heart and into your life and washing all of your sin away. You say, what are you talking about? Here's what I'm talking about. Every human being has been born into this world with an inherent nature of sin because of the fall of Adam and Eve. That's why we have no difficulty sinning. But God said, I don't want to leave you like that. I want to make a way of escape for you, a way out. So his son Jesus went to the cross, and on the cross, he took the sin of all mankind upon himself. And he said, if you will make a decision, a choice, to invite me into your life spiritually, I will come in and wash all of your sin away. So you will become as if you've never ever sinned. But you have to make a choice, a decision to invite me in. At this point, people start making excuses for it not to happen. And they say things like this: I don't want to be religious. We do not want you to be religious either. In fact, we are against religion. Christianity is not a religion in spite of what some people have done with it. Christianity is all about relationship. You say, well, what will people think about me? My friends, my relatives, family. If you live your life based on what people think of you, you're in big trouble. Well, I've got my church. We're not talking about your church, whether it be here or somewhere else. We're talking about Jesus coming into your life and washing all of your sin away. Well, I'll go home and think about it. That's just a very nice way of saying no. Well, I'm okay, you say. All my family's gone to church for years. I'm cool, man. No. Nobody can make this choice for you. You have to make it for yourself. Well, I'm doing the best I can. We hear that a lot. It's not about what you're doing. It's about who you've invited into your life and what Jesus is doing in you. Well, I think I'm a Christian. I hope I am. The reality is this: if you only think you are, if you only hope you are, you probably are not. For if you were, you would never say, I think I am or I hope I am. What you would say is, I know that I am, and there's absolutely no doubt about it. And tonight, I would love the honor and the privilege of praying for people here, young people, middle-aged people, older people, single people, married people, grandparents, for Jesus to come into your heart and into your life to wash your sin away. And in order to do that, I'm going to simply ask you to respond by raising your hand, holding it up high, letting me see it, and I'll acknowledge it and put it down. Would you just raise your hands up now, hold it up. I'm starting on my right, your left. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. Oh man, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34. There's more hands going up. You may put your hands down. God bless you. If there's anybody else you want us to pray for God, Jesus to come into your life to wash your sin away, would you simply just raise your hand if you haven't done it right now? Just put it up if you haven't already done it. Yes, hands are still going up. God bless you. You may put your hands down. Let's stand together. I'm going to ask everybody that raised their hand to take the next step. Just stay with me for a moment till I explain. I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat in a minute, push past the people in the where you're seated, walk down the various aisles, and stand in a line across the front facing me so we can pray for you, for Jesus to come into your life and wash your sin away. You say, do I need to come down here? Well, if you raise your hand, it won't hurt you to come down here. Jesus went all the way to the cross for you. A few steps down here will not hurt you, it will help you. The Bible is very, very clear. If we confess Jesus publicly, He will confess us before His Heavenly Father. And please understand, we're not against you, we are for you, we love you. We do. And most of us here have made this choice, this decision, somewhere, sometime. If you need somebody to come with you, grab somebody and say, come with me. If you brought somebody, invite them to come and come with them. Right now, everybody that raised your hand, over here, back here, down here, over in here, way up the back there, down here, would you kindly step out of your seats right now, walk down the aisles, stand in a line across the front. Here they come. Here they come. Come on. Everyone that raised your hand, come. That's beautiful. Keep coming. Keep coming. God love you.
Jesus, I belong.
Oh, that's beautiful. God love you. God love you. Praise God. This is awesome.
Jesus,
this is awesome. Keep coming.
Jesus,
God bless you. God bless you.
Here's
some more. God bless you.
You're the reason that I breathe.
Oh, hallelujah. Oh, give him another hand. Man, there's a crowd down here. You know what the Bible says? The angels in heaven rejoice over one that comes to Jesus. They're going to have a party tonight. Woo! And here's what we're going to do. I want you to hear me. This lady coming? Come on, dear. We love you. You're brilliant. God, we love you. Oh, this is what I'm about. I love this, man. This is my passion. I live for this. Wow. I was back in Washington, D.C. A friend of mine, they got a new building. They asked me to preach the first message. And at the end, I gave an altar call for people. Oh, come on. God love you. And I gave an altar call for people to get saved. I said this. You think this is just Al doing his thing, but it's not. I know what goes on. We're laying down DNA in this new building in the first service that from here on out, people get saved in this church. Every service. That was 3 years ago. The church has gone from one service to five. Multiply. And there's never been a service where people haven't gotten saved. Come on, that's what they tell me. The last time I was there, we had a huge altar call for people to get saved. And when it was all said and done and I walked down, some of the young guys grabbed me and said, "Old man, you still got it." Yeah. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to ask you not to go back to your seat just for a few minutes. You're going to go with this brilliant pastor. Wave your hand up high so everyone can see you. Okay. And what he's going to do is take you into a side room up through here. You'll only be there a few minutes. They're going to pray with you. They're going to give you some literature. They're going to introduce some friends to you. And they're going to get you to fill out a decision card. While you're in there, we're going to sing a couple of songs. And you're going to come back out of there into the service. And then we're going to pray for the sick. Don't leave. The meeting's not over. We're going to pray for the sick then. Only be a few minutes. So right now, every one of you that is standing, would you turn and follow this man out here? Come on, give him a big hand. Just put the lights up a bit, please. Thank you. Tonight, we want to pray for every person that is sick, suffering, in pain, diseased, hurting. Whatever malfunction in your body, we're believing God to heal you. And I would like, please, to see the hands of all those that are believing God for a miracle in their body tonight. Would you raise your hands? Oh my. Oh. Wow. Wow. They put your hands down. We weren't sure how we were going to do this, but here's the thing, Pastor. It wouldn't fit them in the front. How many of you believe that God heals? How many of you believe that it's His will to do it for you? How many of you are looking and expecting for it to happen? Would you kindly place your right hand, if you can, on the part of your body that is afflicted? And if you can't do that, just put it on your heart. If there are people near you who do not need a miracle, just gently and kindly place your hand on their shoulder. For the Bible says, where two or three shall agree on earth, touching any one thing, it shall be done. And I'm going to ask the entire crowd to pray this prayer, each line out loud after me. When I finish it with an amen, then I'm going to pray a prayer that you do not need to repeat. Here we go. God, tonight I come in the name of Jesus, and I am believing you for a miracle in my life. I trust you. I believe you. I have faith in you. I know you will do it. Your word promises, by your stripes, I was healed. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. He sent his word and he healed them all and delivered them from their destructions. Healed them all and delivered them. Tonight, I rebuke this sickness in my body. I drive it out in the name of Jesus. I command it to leave. I command my body to respond to the word of God and to be healed from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. I'm receiving from you now. The devil's a liar. The sickness has got to go. I'm not tolerating it anymore. Come now, God. Heal me now. Let your fire go into me now. I receive in Jesus' name. Amen. Keep your hand there. Just let me pray. You do not need to repeat this. Father, I stand here as your servant. I rebuke every sickness, every pain, every disease, every malfunction, and I command healing to flow now. Flow from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. I command heads to be healed, necks, jaws, mouths, teeth, nose, eyes, ears, throats to be miraculously healed. Invade their body now. Chest to be healed. Lungs to be healed, stomachs, kidneys, livers, hearts to be healed. I command backs to be healed, vertebrae to be healed, discs to be healed. I command arms and shoulders to be healed, elbows, wrists, hands, fingers to be healed. Pain to go. I command legs to be healed. Knees, feet, toes, ankles to be miraculously healed. I drive out in the name of Jesus sugar diabetes. I I command cancers to wither and die and pass from your body. Every disease to flee. Open ears. Open eyes right now. God, if there's something that needs to be recreated, recreate it now. You are the great creator. I drive arthritis out. Spirit of arthritis, go. I drive the spirit of sickness out. Leave. By faith, I thank you now that you have come and you are starting to heal and minister all over this crowd. From the youngest to the oldest. Now, God, now. Now, God, now. Now, man, I'm feeling the fire of God. And usually when that happens, look out, miracles are going to break loose. Oh, God, do it. Do it. Do it now. We are receiving now. We are believing now. We are accepting now. Now we're going to move into a second phase. It's a faith stage. There will be a third stage. The Bible says in Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. And it goes on to say, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. The context is blessing and praising God. So all over this crowd, whether you know you've been healed or not, we're going to lift our hands to God if you can, and we're going to shout our praises to God for a miracle happening to us. Come on, shout your praises to God. Hallelujah. I receive God. I receive God. I receive in Jesus' name. Shouting to the Lord. I receive. I receive. I receive. I receive. Now just close your eyes. Don't say anything. Don't do anything. Just stand there and let God come to you now. Let him come to you right now. Just receive. Let it happen, God. Now the next stage, and this is your choice. If I'm overseas in a developing country, I tell them to do it. But this is your choice. It's about taking a step of faith. Trying to do what you are unable to do. Try to hear. Try to see. If you couldn't raise your arm, try to raise your arm. If you couldn't bend your leg, try to bend it. You couldn't bend over because of your back. Try to bend over. That's a step of faith. Often people get healed when they do that. It's your call. Your choice. You couldn't turn your neck. Try to turn it. whatever. You understand what I'm saying? Your choice. Just let it happen. Oh, oh, oh. That's it, God. You're here. You're here. You're here. You're here. You're here. Wow, you're here. Oh. Oh. Just letting it flow. Just letting it flow. All right. I would like you to look at me if you can, please. If you know that you have received a miracle of healing tonight, or the beginning of a miracle, would you raise your hands? Oh, Pastor, look at that. Look at that. Oh, turn around and look. People with hands all over this building. Oh, God. Just put your hands down again. I'm going to make that statement again. You know you've been healed, or you've got the beginning of a miracle. Would you raise your hands? Oh, my. That's awesome. What happened to you, sir? I need the microphone. Hang on. Maybe, no, keep standing. Yeah. Yes, sir, what happened? That's not on.
I've had arthritis in both my knees.
You've had arthritis in both your knees.
Yes.
You were in pain?
Yes.
Was the pain consistent? Most of the day?
The more I used my knees, the worse it got.
Right. How long had you had arthritis?
Oh, gosh, I would say probably 15 years.
And what happened tonight?
Tonight, I began, as I was bent over and we were praying, I could feel popping, especially in this right knee, and I'm able to move with less pain now.
Wow. Praise God. That's awesome, man. That's awesome. That's awesome. Who else raised their hand? As soon as I start doing this, the hands go down. Yeah, go over there and find somebody.
I've been dealing with pain on my left knee for about 6 weeks. Miserable.
Hold on. We didn't get the first line. What was that?
I've been dealing with my left knee for about 6 weeks. I can't sleep at night. I'm up. I carry this with me. Everywhere I go at work, I came expecting a miracle. I just got out of work and I came straight here. And God, I can feel the warmth of the Lord just touching my knee. Now I can go like this.
Wow, look at that. Look at that. Woo! Look at that. Thank you, Lord. All right. Somebody else. Right behind you, man. Right there. Yeah.
My left knee was bothering me for about 3 weeks now, and I just felt, I don't know what it was. I can't say that it was a heat. I can't say what the feeling was, but my knee no longer hurts, and I believe that I'm healed.
Praise God for that. Praise God for that. Praise God. All right, yeah.
Okay. I had serious chest pains from my heart, hard to breathe, and I came expecting a miracle, and now I can breathe. I can breathe. My chest pains are gone. Praise God. Jesus is awesome.
We're not against going to the doctor and getting it checked out. Come on, that's the smart thing to do. Yeah, okay.
I actually injured my knee working out. I dropped a bar that weighed about 75 pounds on my kneecap, and right
75
now...
75 pounds? I had a broomstick.
I actually, right now, I mean, it's slowly been increasing, but right now there feels like a ball of fire on the back of my knee. And
wow, that's God. That's God doing it. Yes, sir.
I have been very, very tired.
Start again, please. We couldn't hear you with the clapping.
I have been suffering from extreme tiredness, weariness. I want to do my work and I don't want to do my work. And then I have neck pain and little strokes that caused me to lose sight in my eye. And my husband's had the same thing. We say that together we have a good pair of eyes because he's got one and I got another one. But it's all the way, arthritis, and just a lot of things that I guess supposed to come when we're old. Well, I still feel the pain in my neck, but I feel that by faith, I can believe God that He has started and He's going to finish what He started.
Okay, we believe that. We believe that. Good on you. Where are we?
I'm up here, Reverend.
He's way up the back.
Two months ago, I suffered a stroke, and I was in a coma for 3 weeks, and I'm paralyzed on my left side, but today I was able to move my fingers.
Praise God. Praise God. Wow. Praise God. Over here, okay.
I've been diagnosed with breast cancer for the third time, and now it's in the bones. And God has been really wonderful to me because I'm feeling much better. I'm able to walk, which I wasn't able to do 2 months ago. So
praise
I thank God.
God. Praise God. Oh, yeah. God is good. God is good. Don't let him hold the mic. You hold it, bro. For everybody.
Yeah, I've been dealing with a lot of stomach pain in my stomach, and it turned out to be cancer. And it turned to be in the last stages, and I've lost my insurance, and so I kind of lost hope. And tonight, when you're talking about the sickness, I felt my cancer relieve my stomach. And I felt a lot of stress.
Okay. Yes.
I came tonight believing for a complete healing. I have numerous diagnoses of things wrong in my body. One of the major things was pain in my feet from neuropathy, not from diabetes, but unknown reasons. And it keeps me awake at night. And I have no pain in my feet right now. But I came also, which is even more of a wonderful thing for me, I came believing also for emotional healing. And when we were standing there, I felt like my shoulders just dropped, like a big old heavy yoke came off.
Yes.
My shoulders.
Yeah. That's what we preached about this morning, the yoke being broken. Come on, are you hearing that? Yeah. Praise God. Praise God. Anyone else? Get a couple more.
I'll translate for her.
Okay.
Hace muchos años me descompuse una rodilla, primero corriendo y
many years ago I hurt my knee running.
Después danzando en la iglesia en Guadalajara.
And then I was dancing at church in Guadalajara and I re-injured it there.
Y hace unos meses no podía doblar mi rodilla ni para hincarme, tenía que agacharme con la pierna extendida.
And 2 months ago I couldn't even bend with my knee. If I had to sit down, I had to extend my leg out.
Y cuando estuvimos orando unos por otros, sentí como si alguna pomada fresca estuviera en mi pierna y pude hincarme sin dolor.
And when we're praying for each other, I felt like some balm was rubbed on my knee, and all of a sudden I was able to just bend down on it.
Praise God. Praise God. That's great. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, I've had several surgeries. And this October is going to be 3 months I haven't walked. And I found a doctor who's going to help me. And I had to go to the bathroom right now when I came. I had pain. And now I don't have any pain. But I have faith in God that this doctor is going to help me to to walk again.
Praise God. Right on past that, they're all pointing to somebody right there.
Ever since when I was smaller in kindergarten, my eyes have been having sort of a disease to where I couldn't really see as well as the other kids. But now I can see so much better without my glasses.
Yeah. Praise God. Oh! Praise God. Praise God. Yeah. Praise God. Woo. Who? Who? Man, that's good. A lot of knees getting healed. Well, if you got a painful knee, that's good. Hallelujah. Where is he? Where's my man over here? They're all going over here, waving hands over here. Come on, you'll have to run, man, because you can't see him, but I can. You're shorter than I am.
Yeah, my back was injured in a car accident, and it was broken, and they told me I wouldn't walk. First miracle, I got out of the hospital. This miracle is I bend over and touch my toes, and I haven't been able to do that since 2002. So praise God.
Oh, that's good. Okay, man.
Estoy enferma desde hace más de 20 años de un oído del izquierdo.
I've been sick for about 20 years from my left ear.
Desde el mes de enero hasta el día de hoy no escuchaba nada.
And from January to about today, I haven't been able to hear a thing from my left ear.
No podía respirar de este poro de la nariz tampoco.
And I wasn't able to breathe from the left side of my nose.
Pero el día de hoy le doy la honra y la gloria a Dios porque puedo escuchar y respirar mejor.
But today I give glory to God because I can hear and breathe from my left side.
Hear and see. Praise God. Praise God. Hey, let's give the Lord a big shout offering of thanksgiving. Praise God. Oh! Praise God. May be seated. We promised we'd get you out early. We wouldn't keep you late. We got people raising hands everywhere wanting to testify. But isn't this great? God has done this. Hallelujah. God has done this. Yeah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.